Transition US, national hub of the Global Transition Towns Movement. For more information, call 415-646-5630.
Another community-powered announcement from KPFA.
Oakland Lake Company invites you to experience the magic of Graham Lustig's The Nutcracker, December 17 and 18. This event is wheelchair accessible and it's a benefit for the Oakland Ballet Company. We will celebrate the season at Oakland's stunning Paramount Theater, transform into a winter wonderland complete with toy soldiers, snow maidens, the sugar plum fairy, and the Nutcracker Prince. For tickets, visit oaklandballet.org or call 510-893-3132.
This is Pushing Limits, Disability Radio 2 and 4, and about people with disabilities. It's all of us with the various kind of disabilities. We're here on the first, third, and fifth Fridays of the each month, 2:30 p.m. on KPFA. And eugenics is something we're going to talk about today. Eugenics, which, among other horrors, led to the killing of 275,000 people with disabilities in Nazi Germany. But it's been largely discredited. But eugenic thought lingers on in modern genetics, in the political and cultural framework of science. The dream of a perfected humanity continues. And today we're going to talk to Ann Finger, who wrote about eugenics in the Soviet Union, focusing on developments occurring in the decade after the 1917 revolution in Russia. And Ann Finger is a writer of fiction and nonfiction. Her publications include the short story collection Call Me Ahab and the memoir Elegy for a Disease, A Personal and Cultural History of Polio. She wrote the article The Left Hand of Stalin, which we're going to discuss today, The Left Hand of Stalin, Eugenics in the Soviet Union, and it appears in the volume Disability Politics in a Global Economy, Essays in Honor of Martha Russell, edited by Ravi Malhotra, and that's published by Routledge. And Ann Finger lives in Oakland, so welcome again, Ann. We haven't talked for a while on the radio.
Great to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
You're welcome. First of all, what's your interest in writing this piece? Because we don't really hear too much about disability in Russia, and that's one of the things that really had an appeal to me.
It actually grew out of another project that I'm working on. And then Ravi put together this anthology of in honor of Martha Russell. And one thing that Martha talked about in her really groundbreaking book, Beyond Ramps, was how notions about eugenics, because of the association with Nazi Germany and the kind of horror that grew out of Nazi Germany, are really associated with now with the right wing. But that in fact, eugenic ideology was very widespread, not just in the right, but in the left. So I took the little bit I knew about the Soviet Union and really did a fair amount of research to put this article together, looking at specifically leftist ideology and eugenics.
And one of the things from my reading of the article is there's quite a few interesting people that were involved in Russia at this time, to and fro, this and that. So we're going to ask, I'll ask a little bit about who these individuals were, but it's an interesting read and a wild time. Remind us, what's your definition of eugenics? How would you define it?
I would say eugenics is the belief that the human race can be improved through conscious and deliberate breeding, and that often, but not necessarily, involves state control of breeding. It often involved sterilization of the unfit, quote-unquote, and a demand that the fit produce more children. So, for instance, in Nazi Germany, we saw before the quote-unquote euthanasia campaign where mental patients were killed, which happened within Germany itself and then also happened in the conquered territories as well. But before that, we saw sterilization of people who were deemed to have a hereditary illness. Some of these illnesses were, in fact, hereditary. Some weren't. And also a demand that it's impossible to talk about this without air quotes, but that, like, people of good German stock produce more and more children.
Mm-hmm. Or, in other words, striving for the pure Aryan race.
Exactly.
Yeah. But Russia wasn't necessarily like that, as I understand it, your piece. So can you tell us, prior to the revolution, in the Russian Revolution of 1917, what was, if you were disabled in Russia, what was your status? Were you really bad off, or even maybe can you sense as to what kind of disabilities were prominent then?
You know, I don't have a great sense of that. The one thing I did find out, and, you know, one of the things that's so exciting to me about the field of disability studies is there's so much that we so urgently need to know. And I go back to Doug Baton's statement about disability is everywhere in history once we start to look for it, but notably absent in the histories we write. So, you know, I just hope there's PhD candidates out there who are thinking about what should I write my thesis on and grab hold of this, because there's so much really important work that needs to be done. But one thing that's very certain is that disabled people, and especially people with disabilities that we would now call psych disabilities, were often quite valued in society. So, for instance, they were often seen as holy fools. So there's a cathedral in Moscow that's the Cathedral of Basil, the Holy Fool. And there's instances of people actually going to psych hospitals, mental hospitals, whatever we want to call them at that point, to get advice and counsel from madmen, basically. And that attitude carried over into a lot of Soviet thinking when Darwin's ideas came out. So, for instance, Kropotkin, who was an anarchist.
That's Peter Kropotkin.
Right.
What years was he?
I knew that at one point. Do I know that off the top of my head? He
around 1920 was.
Well, he was born in the middle of the 19th century, okay. And I believe died in around 1920, 1921. You know, one thing that's very interesting about Soviet ideas about evolution and inheritance is that Russia was a very underpopulated nation. And when people went to nature, they didn't go to the tropics, as Darwin and Wallace, who was a contemporary of Darwin and had many similar ideas, you know, formed their ideas in the tropics. Russian evolutionists looked at the north, at Siberia, where things were very depopulated. So this idea of struggle and survival of the fittest and limiting reproduction, which was often central to Northern European and U.S. ideas of eugenics, was really quite foreign in Russia. And one thing that's most interesting to me is that Kropotkin talks about how important as a sociable species that weak-minded fools, the infirm, are to our development, which to me is a fascinating idea.
Yes.
Because it's so different than what we normally think of as Darwinian struggle.
Was he a scientist or a...
He was a scientist. He was a geographer, mm-hmm. And he was also a revolutionary, and was arrested, escaped from the Peter Paul fortress, went into exile in England, and then came back after the after the revolution.
Mm-hmm. So, but he had a more enlightened attitude about those who had, you know, some kind of, were different.
Right. I mean, he really saw that disabled people were kind of fundamental to our, as a species, our development. You know, he talks about poets often being infirm and mad, and that kind of web of difference being so important.
As I understand, though, that in that period, one of the things that was happening that in terms of organizing was that a lot of the disability was due maybe to terrible farm conditions, but also to industry, and capitalism at that time was showing its force in Russia. More and more industry was happening, and a lot of times there was no safeguard, so people were getting hurt on the job. And so some of the left, too, one of their programs was, and this was before the revolution, was disability insurance, which was really important then. So in that sense, there was some work being done or thought being done to disability issues, which when you think about it, is huge. People being disabled on the job when there's bad conditions.
And then, of course, World War One happened. And, of course, we know that always in wars there's, you know, tremendous amount of disability. And that disabled soldiers tend to organize because they do have some kind of collective sense. They're often in military hospitals together.
And do you think that it was the state was largely run at different periods of time? The czars had a different were stronger at different times, and sometimes they were tied in closely with the state religion, the Eastern Orthodoxy. Do you think that had these intersections had much of an influence on what happened with people with disabilities?
I don't know about that, but I do know that you know, the whole notion of evolution really undercut the idea that there was a special religious linkage between God and the Tsar and and leading down to the common people. That the whole notion of evolution really struck at the core of those beliefs.
Mm-hmm. And in your studying, have you found anything where Marx or Engels ever wrote about disability or even the eugenics?
I don't think they ever wrote about eugenics, but certainly Engels wrote in very interesting ways about disability in the condition of the working class in Manchester in 1844, where he really does describe in quite interesting ways the issue that you were referring to before in terms of industrialization causing disability. And I think also the other thing that's so interesting in Engels' work in The Condition of the Working Class in Manchester in 1844, such a title, excuse me, is that it's really, he's writing before the idea of the standardization of labor has taken place. And so, for instance, he talks about how outrageous it is that the workday begins at the same time for everyone, no matter how far away they live, and that everyone's supposed to work at the same rate. You know, now we're so used to those ideas. Like, of course you have to be at work on time. It doesn't matter where you live. It doesn't matter how far away you are. Of course everybody has to work at the same rate. That's just accepted. Whereas for him, that system was so new, and to him it seemed really outrageous. Like, you really expect somebody who's old to work at the same pace as somebody who's young? Because in pre-industrial societies, of course you didn't have that.
Mm-hmm. And I recall that seemed to be one of the tenets in Bolshevik thought was that, you know, sometimes when people, some workers could not be as productive than others, then the system's supposed to make up for that.
Well, I also think Marx's slogan, from each according to their abilities to each according to their needs, is has a great deal of application to disability.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And so during the revolution, the Russian Revolution, I'm talking about the 1917 one, the one that actually overturned the previous system, the provisional government. Do we know if there were many people with disabilities that were involved in it, or were there disability issues that helped motivate the effort?
We do know that there were meetings of disabled people. So, for instance, Trotsky talks about, in his history of the Russian Revolution, he talks about a meeting of invalids. Again, where I'm making those air quotes. In 1918, a meeting of invalids was called Soldiers and Officers Together in an amphitheater. An orator cripple began to cast aspersions on the officers. A noise of protest arose, a stamping of shoes, canes, crutches. These wounded, cell-shocked, mutilated people stood like two walls facing one another. Crippled soldiers against crippled officers, the majority against the minority, crutches against crutches. So clearly there was organization happening, but clearly a real history of that has yet to be written.
Okay. And can you compare the status of people with disabilities before and after the Russian Revolution? Was disability touched upon in the program of the Bolsheviks?
I think it was addressed as a social needs issue, and certainly Alexander Kollontai, who we were talking about earlier, when we were talking before the show, ran a social welfare agency that dealt a lot with the needs of children and women and disabled people. Of course, there was tremendous economic hardship at that time. So certainly the kind of programs that, you know, that we would have liked to have seen in place, that the Bolsheviks would have liked to have seen in place, were just because of the hardness of life at that time lacking.
So let's talk a little bit more about Alexandra Kollontai. And the reason I'm interested in her was because she's one of the few females that appears in your history, and perhaps not too many females had really a prominent role in these kind of social issues during this time. So that's why she did contribute as a sexual radical, I think she's referred to. You write that sexual radicals such as Alexandra Kollontai, having argued for the separation of love from marriage and conception from sexual activity, argued that reproduction could logically also be separated from loving relationships and organized into a rational and eugenic basis. That's kind of pretty heavy stuff.
It is heavy stuff. I mean, she's somebody who I feel enormous admiration for her as a sexual radical, as someone who really challenged monogamy, challenged patriarchy, and then... you know, eugenics was a common sense ideology at that point. And it was interesting to me to see how the ideology of eugenics got perpetuated within that radical demand for sexual rights and feminist rights.
We are speaking today here on Pushing Limits with Ann Finger, and we're talking about her article she wrote for an anthology edited by Ravi Malhotra, and her article is called The Left Hand of Stalin, Eugenics in the Soviet Union. And we're about over halfway through the program, and there's a whole lot of stuff we're going to cover, so I don't even know if we could be covered. We probably won't be able to get to all these really interesting characters, but we talked a little bit about Alexandra. How about this? Well, let's talk about Paul Kammerer. Who is he?
He was an Austrian biologist, a leftist, and one of the issues in the early Soviet Union that was very much a contentious scientific issue was about the inheritance of acquired characteristics. And Darwin, for instance, believed in the inheritance of inherited characteristics. He did not know about genes at the point when he was formulating his theory. And Kammerer has apparently faked some of his research and did commit suicide. And it's not really clear how much of that was because he was discovered faking some of his research. You know, for a long time, anybody who believed in the inheritance of acquired characteristics was kind of dismissed as, you know, foolish, and this was a ridiculous idea. Now, with the study of epigenetics, we are beginning to see that there can be some effect of environment on gene in ways that we hadn't seen before.
Okay. So, as I understand, acquired characteristics, if let's say your father is really doing something really good and has this really special skill, that skill could be transmitted by the genes to newborns, or what?
You know, that is probably completely untrue. Mm-hmm. before people knew about the gene, though, that was the way people had of understanding inheritance. But certainly, you know, now that people are looking at epigenetics, we are seeing ways that, for instance, your grandmother's nutrition may have an effect on you, things like that. But it's not obviously, you know, that cartoonish version of inherited genetics where, you know, your father's a blacksmith, so you'll have strong arms. But there does seem to be some influence of environment on gene. And it's complicated and not at all well understood, but enticing new science.
But that could have importance for our generation, our future generations, if you could control for prevention of cancer by doing a social change, prohibiting certain chemicals from infecting the environment. It's kind of...
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously a long way off. And I think the important thing to say in terms of thinking about the environment is... and toxins is we don't know what the effect is, but we know they're not good for us. And so I think however poorly understood the effect of that on the genome is that we know environmental toxins aren't good for us.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's see. You wrote in your piece that there were two major strains of eugenics operating in the Soviet Union at that time. What were those major strains that major thoughts that were going on that were in conflict with each other?
Well, I think there was this. There were different schools in terms of inherited characteristics,
okay.
And some people said, you know, if we believe in inherited characteristics, it means that the oppression of the working class is written into people's very existence. And other people felt that that really looking at the gene itself was a much more fruitful tack to take.
Mm-hmm. And how did Marxist... was it in between those two strains or what? Marxist thought.
Well, I would say that both of those strains would probably use some Marxist thought to justify themselves. But I think when Marx talks about the human nature and interaction, he's really not talking... I mean, the laws of nature don't follow the dialectic. And I think that's part of what was difficult in that period in terms of thinking about when Marx is talking about the unfolding of history, he's really talking about humanity and not about nature. And I think sometimes a kind of crude version of Marxism was applied to discussions of nature.
Mm-hmm. Now, undergirding this whole thing during this period, there's Joseph Stalin.
Yes.
And it seems he had a voice of influence in a whole lot of areas. So what was his role around this tension between these arguments at that time?
Well, he really saw eugenics as a right-wing science. And he was also, eugenics was in many ways connected to the kind of utopian visionary wing of communism. It was associated with Trotsky, and he was very suspicious of that and very suspicious of any attempt to biologize. And, you know, one of the most interesting people who I talk about in the article is an American named H.J. Muller, who went to the Soviet Union. He actually later on won the Nobel Prize for his work on mutations in fruit flies. But he had a vision of artificial insemination by sort of the best people, who he defined not just as the most intelligent people, but as people who showed high traits of cooperation, that women would get inseminated with this kind of excellent sperm, and the working class would kind of rise to great heights through alternate through artificial insemination. And he wrote a book called Out of the Night, A Biologist's View of the Future. And he had it translated into Russian and sent to Stalin. And Stalin was not happy about these ideas. And Mueller got out of the country, but his secretary was shot and one of his collaborators was shot. I believe also the person who translated the work was shot.
Mm-hmm.
So those ideas were suppressed in pretty horrific ways.
Okay. And toward the end of the program, do you have a sense? We missed a lot of, we weren't able to talk to a lot of these characters, but do you have a sense, say around the 60s, where the disability organizing or the status of disabilities was around that time?
You know, disability was really seen as something that was going to be cured and fixed, which meant that when people couldn't be cured and fixed, they were often just shunted aside. So, for instance, when I'm not sure exactly of the year, but when the Paralympics were being organized, I believe it was in the early 1970s, somebody in one of the Olympic officials in the Soviet Union said, there are no invalids in the Soviet mm-hmm. Union. So there was this notion that, you know, science and medicine were going to fix everybody and there would be no disability anymore. And, of course, that didn't happen. It just meant that disabled people were hidden away.
Yeah, that was also toward the end of the Soviet system.
Yeah.
We have Putin and other characters and other main forces in that country. Anyhow, one of the things I appreciate about the article was that eugenics is, you know, there's different strains, different levels. It didn't have to be what the Nazi practice or the terrible ways we use eugenics in this country before. And we've spoken a little bit about that before, but it was nice talking to you, Ann Finger, about eugenics in the Soviet Union. And hopefully, this article and others from this volume will spark further interest among young academics and others to know more about what's happening internationally in disability and about these issues, because they're also very interesting and impactful and vital. So thanks a lot for coming in.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
I can't stop now. Now maybe someday I'll reach that higher goal.
Have you ever considered producing a community radio show? If that's the case, please pay attention. The Pacifica National Board has approved a motion to implement 5 new hours of programming in Spanish per week at every station of Pacifica, which includes Houston, Los Angeles, Berkeley, Washington, D.C., and New York. If you or someone you know is interested, please send us an email to programacion-espanol@pacifica.org or visit your local Pacifica radio website. Pacifica speaks Spanish.
KPFA in Berkeley, 94.1. KPFB in Berkeley at 89.3. KFCF in Fresno, 88.1. KPFA.org.